Good morning, everybody. Let me start my today's talk with this clinical scenario. A 45-year-old female who had difficulty in walking and significant lower limb pain came to my clinic with this lumbar spine MRI, and she was awaiting a lumbar spine surgery. When I examined her, I realized that she had significant upper motor neuron signs. So I sent her back for a screening MRI, which showed she had significant compression in cervical spine also, and this also required surgery. This would have been missed without a proper clinical evaluation. Hence, the first message that I would like to give you all is a proper clinical evaluation is must before you consider spine MRI. Another clinical scenario. 70-year male having back pain for a year, and he started developing lower limb weakness. So he got his MRI at some remote center in India, where the radiologist said that infection is more likely and neoplasm is less likely. So without taking any biopsy, the treating surgeon put him on antitubercular treatment. His condition kept on worsening. And when he came to us, he was having cauda equina syndrome, and we had to operate him on emergency basis. And the biopsy that we sent intraoperatively showed a synovial cell sarcoma. This would have been picked up earlier, provided he would have undergone a biopsy at appropriate time. So MRI is a tool that can help you to reach diagnosis, provided you use it properly along with other investigations and a thorough clinical evaluation. So with this, let me start my today's talk on spinal MRI, what every orthopedic surgeon must know. Decoding spine MRI doesn't mean reading an MRI report. It actually means trying to correlate your clinically significant finding with that of radiological findings. There are three main views of spine MRI. The first is the sagittal view, where we look at the spine from the side. Second is the axial view, which is basically a cut section view of the spine. And the third is the coronal view, where we visualize the spine from the front. There are two important sequences of spine MRI, T2 weighted sequence and T1 weighted sequence. And in special circumstances, we do use a fat suppressed sterile sequence, post contrast gadolinium enhanced sequence, or a diffusion weighted sequence. When we talk about the two main sequences, the striking difference is how the water containing tissues are visualized. So on T1 weighted image, higher the water content, the signal will be hypointense or dull in intensity, whereas in T2 weighted image, higher the water content, brighter will be the signal. So on the left hand side, you can see a T1 weighted image where the CSF is dull in color, whereas on the right hand side, you can see a T2 weighted image where CSF is white in color. The first MRI film that we should see is a screening MRI. And one should make a habit of ordering a screening MRI whenever they are ordering an MRI of a particular region. This will prevent missing any pathologies above or below the region of interest. So on screening MRI, which is a T2 weighted sagittal image, you can see the lower portion of brain, cervical spine, thoracic spine, lumbar spine, and sacrum. There are two points to note here. First, the counting is always done from the top in an MRI. And second, the spinal cord usually ends at the lower border of L1. It is not necessary that everybody will have same number of lumbar vertebrae. Sometimes there can be a 4 lumbar vertebrae with the 5th vertebrae being sacralized, or it has already become a part of sacrum. And sometimes the first sacral vertebrae may be lumbarized, giving rise to 6 lumbar vertebrae. Now it is important to note, because on X-ray or on an intraoperative fluoroscopy image, we do counting from the bottom, whereas in MRI, we start counting from the top. So the last mobile segment, which is usually alpha S1 for a fluoroscopy or an X-ray, may be actually alpha 5 on MRI in case of sacralized L5, or S1 S2 in case of a lumbarized S1. And one should be aware of this variation, otherwise wrong surgeries can eventually happen. When we visualize the T2-weighted slider image, apart from the bright CSF, the other structures that we can see include the intermediate intensity of the vertebral body, the disc, which are bright in color when they are hydrated, and it becomes dull in color when they turn, when they degenerate or when they are dehydrated. T2-weighted paracerebral cut can give a good information of the foraminal structures. And on T2-weighted axial image, you can see the dural sac and the spinal cord in case of cervical dorsal spine, whereas the nerve roots can be seen in the lumbar spine. The structure anterior to the dural sac is the disc, whereas the structure posterior to the dural sac are the facet joints. You can also see the traversing and the exiting nerve root at different cervical and the lumbar spinal levels, and any compression on this traversing or the exiting nerve root can be very well visualized on MRI T2-weighted axial image. So the common pathologies that you see on T2-weighted axial sequence include the degenerative pathologies. You can see a disc degeneration, which is characterized by a black disc. You can see an annular tear, which is a hyperintense zone in the posterior aspect of the intervertebral disc. You can identify a contained herniation where the disc has not crossed traversed the PLL. You can also identify a disc protrusion or an extruded or sequestrated disc on a T2-weighted slider image. On T2-weighted axial image, the posterior surface of the disc is usually concave, and when it loses its concavity and becomes convex, it is usually reported as disc bulge, which may or may not be of clinical significance. Clinically significant findings include a central disc herniation, a paracentral herniation, a foraminal herniation, or an extraforaminal herniation. Apart from disc pathologies, even stenosis, one of the degenerative changes giving rise to a claudication, can also be identified on an MRI. So on the left hand side, you can see the dural sac and the nerve roots lying freely, whereas on the right hand side, because of the herniated disc, the phloem hypertrophy, there is a significant compression and clumping of the nerve roots, which can be visualized on a T2-weighted axial and sagittal image. You can also differentiate between the two common types of spondylolisthesis, that is the lytic and degenerative listhesis. So in lytic listhesis, there is usually a past defect, but there is no signs of degeneration. So the canal is wide, whereas in degenerative listhesis, you can see phloem hypertrophy, disc herniation, giving rise to a significant canal stenosis. So the canal of lytic listhesis is wide, whereas in degenerative listhesis, it is narrow, or in some cases, it may be completely obliterated. If you look at the facet in case of degenerative listhesis, they are arthritic, they show osteophytes, whereas in lytic listhesis, the facet joints are usually spared, but on the paracentral cut, you can see a past defect and a foraminal stenosis, which is characteristic of lytic listhesis. Similar to lumbar spine, you can also identify the causes of cervical stenosis, be it cervical disc osteophyte or an ossified ligament complex. MRI has a special role in spine trauma. If you look at this X-ray, you can definitely identify fracture dislocation. But what this X-ray won't tell you is, why is this patient having neurological deficit? And that answer can only be provided by an MRI, where you can see a significant bony piece compressing on the spinal nerve roots. Apart from this, it is important to identify ligamentous injury for fracture classification and for subsequent treatment. And sometimes the herniation or an hematoma post-trauma may be the cause of neurological deficit, and that can only be identified on a spine MRI. In certain cases, the patient may have a pre-existing stenosis, which due to a whiplash injury, the patient may develop cord damage and cord edema. And these are the findings can only be shown on an MRI, because X-ray or CT scan of such patients will be absolutely normal. Moving forward, these are the T1 weighted images. You can see the majority of the structures are dull in color, except the vertebral body, which is of intermediate intensity. And the another important use of T1 weighted paracel image is visualization of the foraminal structures. Because of the hypointense structures, the foramen is very well demarcated, and any foraminal stenosis compression can be very well visualized on T1 weighted images. T1 weighted axial images, again, the majority of structures are dull in color, and so it is of seldom of any benefit in routine practice for diagnostic purpose. T1 weighted sequences are important when we are looking at marrow invasion. So usually the bright or intermediate intensity signal of the vertebral body is because of fatty marrow. So when it is replaced by an infection, it becomes dull in color. When it is replaced by a tumor invasion, it becomes dull in color. And when it is replaced by an edema fluid, it becomes dull in color. So yes, many times or the differentiation between these three can only best be done with the help of a biopsy, but the invasion of the marrow tissue is the first sign, you know, and maybe the earliest sign in case of an infection, trauma, or a tumor. Sometimes we do utilize STIR sequences, which are basically fat suppressed sequences. And you can see this is T2 weighted serial image. The STIR basically is similar to T2 weighted image, except the fat component is suppressed. And so this is a very good sequence for visualization of fluid, especially in case of an infection or any cystic collection in and around the spinal cord. It is also important for differentiating new and old osteoporotic fractures. So you can see this patient having multiple osteoporotic fractures. And on the right hand side, you can see there is a hyperintense signal in the vertebral bodies marked with red arrow, which indicate that these are recent fractures, whereas the vertebral body marked with white is hypointense, indicating that it is a old fracture. Sometimes we do go for a post contrast sequence. The contrast is injected intravenously, and it is very important for identifying vascular structures. So suppose if a patient is having post-operative pain and you want to differentiate a recurrent disc from an epidural scarring, contrast sequences are very important, because epidural scarring, they won't show any hyperintense signal, whereas a recurrent disc herniation, because of the inflammation, will show peripheral enhancement around the re-herniated portion of the disc. Similarly, abscess cavity will be hypointense, but the peripheral tissue around the abscess will be hyperintense in a post-contrast sequence. Whereas in case of tumor, there will be uniform hyperintense signal. And similarly, granuloma also show a hyperintense signal on post-contrast sequences. There are certain drawbacks of spine MRI. Spine MRI may not always identify instability. There are certain predictors, you know, which indicate that there might be an instability, but it cannot establish that this patient is having an instability or a listhesis. So I'll give you some examples. So sometimes a mild listhesis can give a clue that the patient may have some instability. A wet facet, fluid in the facet more than 3 millimeter, or arthritic or subluxated facet, this can definitely predict. But there are instances, like in this, you can see the MRI shows normal degenerative changes without any lysis or listhesis. But when we did flexion extension view, you can see there is a significant forward and backward listhesis, which could have been easily missed on a spine MRI. Second is, not all things that you see on spine MRI is important. On the left hand side, you can see a patient with a large disc herniation. And on the right hand side, you can see a patient with small disc herniation. So in spite of having the large disc, the patient was asymptomatic, whereas on the right hand side, in spite of having a small disc, this patient was symptomatic because it was directly hitting on the nerve. So the take home message that I would like to give you all is, always correlate MRI with the clinical picture. Second, always ask for screening of whole spine whenever you are going for a detailed study of the affected region. Third, T2 weighted images are the key images for evaluation of most of the spine pathologies. And fourth, T1 weighted images are useful for infection, tumor, and trauma evaluation. Thank you. Thank you.